sing. There's a fountain. Be seated.
Have you ever seen a more engaging little girl in all your life? She's just twisting around and looking at everything. And, well, she's a sweet little girl, and I'm just really impressed that she's... Do you know that the name Coralie comes from fine jewelry that was made with a particular kind of coral in the ancient world? And so that's where her name comes from. And I thought, well, that makes her a jewel, both for the church and for her family. And so we want to treat you like that, like you're very special and precious and very, very important in the life of the church. Now, we're doing this thing that we call baby dedication, Coralie, where we want to present you to the Lord. But really, it's not a baby dedication.
It's more of a family dedication. Are we okay? All right. Get anything on me? It's more of a family dedication than a church dedication, because what we want your parents to do is help you come to know and love Jesus as your Lord and Savior. And we're going to ask this church if they'll do the same thing, to do everything they can to help you. So, church, will you support this family and especially minister to this little girl to help her come to know Jesus as her Lord and Savior?
We will.
Right. And parents, will you lead her to Christ? Will you show her what it is to live a life of devotion to Him and give her every opportunity to give her life to Him freely and fully? Let's pray.
Our Father, we bow in your presence. We thank you for this family. We thank you for this little girl, Coralie. We ask that your blessings would be upon each of them and upon your church as we witness this occasion. We pray, our Father, for Coralie, that in her time, as you work in her life, she will come to know Jesus as her Lord and Savior. That she will give her life to Him without reservation, that she will serve Him with all of her strength, that she will grow in the grace and the knowledge of her Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Thank you, Father, for hearing our prayer for this family, for this little girl. We offer in the name of Jesus, our Lord and Savior. And all God's people said,
Amen.
Would you please stand as we sing Heavenly Sunlight?
Good morning, First Baptist. I am not Charles Hill this morning. I'm David Johnson. I'm filling in for Charles for the first half of the show. And I want to say that I know I mentioned last week about Brother Tom, how he does such a remarkable job with these babies. I think he'd be a great candidate to go down and work in the nursery. You do a very good job, Brother Tom. But anyway, if you are a visitor for the first time, we would like to know about you. There's a pamphlet in front of the pew, in front of you, directly in front of you, by the Bible and by the psalm book, hymn book. If you want to take that, pull it out, and put your name and on it, fill it out, and put it in the offering plate as it comes by, we will have a record of your attendance. We would like to have that record. But also, if needed, there's a place for you to put any prayer concerns if you have, or any kind of concerns that you would like to share with us. And I would like to everyone to join me in a brief moment of prayer, a short moment of silence and then prayer, and then after that we'll have our greeting. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we speak to you here through our minds in a moment of silence, through your heavenly sunlight that you give us. Father, we thank you so much for this place of worship, the opportunity to think about you, to share, to love you, to be so thankful for all the things that you've done for us. Father, as we go through this service today, we want to be reminded that we're always and will be sinners. But there's one thing we have hope, and that's the chance of everlasting life through Jesus Christ. In your name, amen. Let's rise and have our greeting, please.
Thank you.
I want to read to you this morning from 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 13 through 18. And if you would like, you may follow along in the pew Bible that's there. I didn't look up the page number, but you can find 2 Corinthians 4, verse 13 and following. Paul writes, "Since we have the same spirit of faith, according to what has been written, I believed and so I spoke, we also believe and so we also speak, knowing that he who raised the Lord Jesus will raise us also with Jesus and bring us with you into his presence. For it is all for your sake, so that as grace extends to more and more people, it may increase thanksgiving to the glory of God. So we do not lose heart. Though our outer self is wasting away, our inner self is being renewed day by day. For this light, momentary affliction is preparing for us an eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison, as we look not to the things that are seen, but to the things that are unseen. For the things that are seen are transient, but the things that are unseen are eternal." May God bless to our good this reading and hearing of his word in Scripture. Let me share a couple of thoughts with you at this point about this text, that emerged from this text for me. When you go to the cemetery, you look for a couple of things. First of all, you look for a name. And then you look at the dates. There's a birth date and a date of death. But the most significant, the most important marker on the tombstone is the dash. See, the dash represents your life, what you do here and now. And when we meet the Lord in the final judgment, he's going to want to discuss the dash. Nothing else but the dash. He's going to want to talk about that. So let's talk about the dash for a few moments. The significance of your dash is knowing and doing God's will in your life. Knowing and doing God's will, it's very personal for each of us, and in fact, it's a very important kind of consideration. Jesus said at the end of the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew 7:21, "Not everyone who says to me, 'Lord, Lord,' will enter the kingdom of heaven, but the one who is doing the will of my Father who is in heaven will enter the kingdom of heaven." Now, that's an amazing thing. And the way the text translates, "the one who is doing the will of my Father who is in heaven," the idea is that it's an ongoing activity. It's a part of our life here and now. It's not something that we're going to get to later. It's not something that happened once upon a time. It's something that we're doing in the here and now. It's a part of our lifestyle, that it's a passionate desire for us to know and do the will of God in our lives. Well, some of us need to resurrect the concept of the will of God when it comes to decision making and doing things in the life of faith. Knowing and doing his will with the living of our lives can take a greater priority for all of us than just what we want to do with our time and with our lives. Knowing and doing the will of God should have a higher priority concern for us because we have turned our lives over to Jesus. We've given ourselves to God through faith in him. So we may need to resurrect the concept of knowing and doing the will of God as a way of deciding on how we're going to go forward with the living of our lives. It's true also for our church. As we together make decisions about the future of our church, we should give consideration to what is the will of God for us as his body. Some of us need to embrace that truth. I have an idea. I don't hear much talk about it anymore, about a lot of things that seemed to be really important when I was younger in the faith. But the idea of knowing and doing the will of God, of having it as a priority in life, seems to be lost on younger generations of Christians. So I think it's an important thing that we embrace this idea, understanding that it's an important thing for us to know, that we can know the will of God, we can do the will of God. It's something that could affect all of our lives, that we can live our lives in harmony with God's will, that we can make all of our life decisions on the basis of knowing his will. So I think for younger Christians, that may be a good thing to embrace, a good idea to embrace. But it's not as easy as it sounds. In fact, there are some interesting ways that people have tried to discern what God's will for their lives can be. A woman had a long-standing ambition to go to the Holy Land, and she had saved the money, and she had the time, and everything was set to go, but she was just not quite convinced that it was the will of God for her to go to the Holy Land. And so she agonized over deciding whether or not to go. Despite the fact she had the money, she had the time, she could have made the arrangements and taken off on her trip, but she just didn't know that it was God's will for her to do so. She was looking at a pamphlet one night about the trip that she was wanting to take, and she noticed that she was going to be flying there and back on a 747 jumbo jet, which piqued her attention. She thought, well, that's a good thing. But she laid down, and after a fitful night of thinking about this and not knowing whether or not God wanted her to go to the Holy Land, she woke up in the morning and she looked at her digital clock, and guess what time it was? 7:47. And she decided, this is a sign from God. He really wants me to go to the Holy Land. Now, some of you are kind of chuckling at that. That's kind of fanciful and circumstantial and coincidental and all of that, and may or may not have anything to do with the will of God. I frankly think that that's more hocus pocus. It's kind of like when you want to get a word from God and you haven't spend any time in your Bible, and so you want to get a word from God, you do the drop and flop method of Bible study. That is, you let your Bible fall open on the table before you, and you put your finger, and you read that verse, and it's God speaking to you. There are a lot of people that believe that that's the way to do it, that God will direct your hand. It's interesting that most of the time when you drop and flop Bible study, your Bible opens to the Psalms. You know why the Bible opens to the Psalms? Biggest book, and it's right there in the middle. And so, little hocus pocus there. Pastor had been a deacon, serving for many, many years in a couple of different churches as a deacon. But the Lord called him to the ministry, called him to preach. And before he was ordained to the ministry, he had this call. And so he became a minister. And he was thinking about how he could get credentials for the ministry, and he came across one of those degree mills. You can see them online. You used to be able to read about them in magazines and newspapers and all the degree mills. And you know, you pay your money and you can get your degree. You can get your ordination. You can do everything online now. And so he was thinking about getting a doctorate. So he happened to be reading in his Bible 1 Timothy 3:13, "For they that have used the office of deacon well purchase to themselves a high degree." And he said, "Got to buy that PhD, you know, that degree." That's hocus pocus, you know. That's crazy. That's sadly true for a lot of people. Will of God is not that kind of mysterious sort of thing, and yet we tend to let circumstances direct our thinking about the will of God more than anything else. Well, there's a better way to go about it, better way to go about understanding and knowing and doing the will of God. You will better determine God's unique will for your life if you know God's universal will for all Christians. And it may be hard to understand that you can know that, but I've given you something that will help you with that. Everybody have your listening guide with you here this morning? I'm not even going to make you fill it out because I want you to get this. And so everything you need to know from this point on is right here in your listening guide, and I want to encourage you to give some thought to what you find on that page. There are four verses of Scripture in the Bible that specifically mention this is the will of God for you. This is God's will. It definitely states that God's will is being unfolded in these verses. John 6:40 reading along with me. For this is the will of my Father, that everyone who looks on the Son and believes in him should have eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 3. For this is the will of God, your sanctification, that you abstain from sexual immorality. And 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 18 says, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. And then 1 Peter 2:15 says, for this is the will of God, that by doing good you should put to silence the ignorance of foolish people. Now, I want to encourage you with something. I want to, a little caveat here. Every verse in Scripture has a larger context. So don't just let me pull these verses out and throw them at you to say anything more than that there's a definite statement about God's will for us in these four verses of Scripture. And so what it suggests to me is that we ought to pack our bags for the journey through life walking in God's will. Let's look at it this way. I've used BAGS as an acronym, B-A-G-S, to help us remember what each of these verses says. The first verse that I mentioned a moment ago tells us to believe in Jesus. That if you're actively believing in Christ, trusting in him, and walking by faith in him, then that's the first thing that you need to do in order to discover and know and do the will of God. Believe in Jesus for your salvation. Believe in Jesus for the guidance that you need. Believe in Jesus. The second thought is that of abstaining from sexual immorality. It's interesting to me that that comes to the fore. That is specifically stated in an over-sexualized culture such as we have in our country today, in our culture now. It's hard to avoid it. In fact, sexual immorality is a bigger problem than most of us clean-looking Christians in this place today would care to admit. For the availability of pornographic material is everywhere, and especially on the internet, and the statistics are that one in three of us, men and women, are actively involved in pornographic material using the internet. Now, I don't think it's an innocent kind of an experience for us to do that. It damages our relationships. It objectifies the other person for us, makes them a thing rather than a person. It does all kinds of, wrecks all kinds of havoc with us in the living of our lives, and it's prominent. It prevails throughout every sector of our culture. In fact, the statistics about the beginnings of sexual activity for young people, very, very high. High school students, one in two are already sexually active, according to some of the records that I've seen. Will of God for us all Christians is that we abstain from sexual immorality, that we back away from it, that we wrestle with the temptation. That's always going to be there. So much a part of our culture, so much a part of our history, so much a part of our life. But we don't have to go there. By the grace of God, we can abstain from it. And so that would be a second qualification for knowing and doing God's unique will for each of our lives, knowing that this is true for all of us. We should abstain from sexual immorality. We should give thanks in everything. Give thanks in every circumstance, because this definitely is the will of God for you. Now, it's hard to give thanks to God when things are going wrong, right? Correct? Hard to give thanks when you're under the gun, when you're going through a trial, when you're facing temptation, when you're having a difficult moment. Hard to give thanks to God. Easy to thank God if you can acknowledge that he has blessed you and that he's provided for you, that he's protected you along the way, that he's done all kinds of things in your life. Easy to acknowledge God when that's going on. But when everything is against you and all the props are being knocked out from under you, it's hard to give thanks to God. But this is God's will for you. By the way, it shapes your whole inner life. It shapes your whole self on the inside. And it causes a kind of radiance to extend to other people if you can spend time giving thanks for everything, in every circumstance, giving thanks to God. He's right there in the midst of it with you. Surely you can give thanks to the Lord. Fourth, you can submit to doing what is right. Submit to doing what is right when the whole world is against you, and it's becoming increasingly against us Christians in our country now. We're going to be pressured to recant our faith and to give up living this, or to compromise, or to keep it to ourselves and not say anything to anybody else. Those kinds of pressures are mounting. We're being increasingly marginalized in the culture that we live in. The distance between genuine Christian faith and ethics and behavior and all that, and what's taking place in the world around us, from the seats of government to all the way down to the local social clubs that we're a part of, the distance is so great, and we're being marginalized as a result of that. In the midst of it all, we have to have the good Jewish word, chutzpah. Have to have the strength, the inner strength, to do right, to do good, no matter what, no matter what the pressure is. So I want to encourage you. Take this little listening guide and ponder those verses, read them in context, and take those four things. This is the will of God for all Christians. And if you're living out this will of God that applies to all Christian lives, then your personal, individual, unique will of God for you will become clearer to you. You're not likely to pursue for yourself the will of God if you're not willing to pursue the will of God for all Christians. So I want to encourage you to use this four verses out of the New Testament to tell us what the will of God is. So let's bow together. Let's have a word of prayer, and then we'll continue in our worship service. Our Father in heaven, thank you for giving us these four direct statements of your will for all Christians. It's your word to us. It's you speaking life to us. It's your giving us direction that you want us to heed. Thank you for your mercy and grace. In the times of sorrow that we all face, in moments of pure delight, when we discern you, when we see you clearly, in our circumstances and in our midst, in the times of worship that we have together, when we are fellowshipping with other believers, when we recognize you are among us. You call us to pray with confidence in you, confident that we will receive mercy and find grace, especially in our times of need, but for all occasions, in every circumstance of life. Mercy and grace is what makes it rich for us. It seasons us. Confident that even when we don't know what to pray, your Spirit helps our weakness. Your Spirit intercedes for us with unspoken groanings and in accord with the will of God. We're even told in the book of Hebrews that Jesus is always interceding for us. So we bow in your presence and we pray for each other with gratitude for the faith in our Lord Jesus Christ that we share. We give thanks for the love we have for all our brothers and sisters in Christ. We pray with longing for everyone here now to believe and to be saved. And we pray for our children to trust Christ and to be saved, to walk with him, to dedicate themselves to him, to give their lives over to him. And we pray for all of us to begin again, to live in the middle of your will, to pursue your purposes for our lives as we come to know and understand it. Bring us together to build a bridge to our neighbors. We need that unity, and we need that passion. We need more than what we can do to encourage one another in this venture. We need your Spirit moving on our hearts. Grant that we may build each other up in love. Bless our upcoming vacation Bible school. Bring many children to us. Help us show them the gospel and help them believe. Add to your church such as should be saved. Prepare our students to go on mission to Belle Chasse. Grip their hearts with your majesty. Move them by your love. For all the world, make them, enable them, help them to begin to love like you love us. Help them serve. Forgive all of us our sins as we forgive others. A big deal in our spiritual lives, our walk in the Spirit, to be forgiven and to forgive. We ask that it be true in our lives. Always deliver us from the evil one who rages against all of us, who disguises himself as an angel of light, seeking to deceive us, seeking to take from us our joy in trusting you, desiring to bring our witness to nothing before a watching world. Empower us with the strength of your might, that Christ may dwell in our hearts by faith, and that we be united in love. To your glory, honor, and praise, for our good, we pray. In the name of Jesus, the name above all names, amen.
Let's stand and sing Living for Jesus. Living
Aren't you enjoying our worship these days with baby dedications and baptisms that speak to the new life that our Lord Jesus Christ can give all of us? Isn't this a wonderful thing that's going on here? I want to introduce you to Dawn Jett in just a moment. Dawn has put her faith in Christ as her Savior and comes today confessing that she believes in Jesus, and you, at the same time, are welcoming her into the family of faith and acknowledging that she has faith and affirming her in that faith. And so this is a conversation between the two of you, our congregation and Dawn. Let me introduce you to Dawn. Dawn, that's it. Get a good grip on me now. I don't want to lose you. Okay? All right. Dawn, this that we're doing now, this baptism, is very special and significant for you because it's a picture of spiritual realities that have taken place in your life. You have been buried with Jesus spiritually through this baptism. And you will be raised up to walk in new kind of life with Jesus. And it's all a picture of one day, at the end of the age, the Lord Jesus is going to raise your body. And you will be resurrected to eternal life to be with him forever. This is a marvelous, marvelous picture of what's taking place in your life spiritually. It gives me great pleasure because you've trusted in Christ to baptize you as my little sister in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Let's pray together. Our Father, we give you thanks and praise that you're still a God who can reach out and save us, that you call people to yourself because of your mercy and grace, that you give them new life and raise them from the dead, literally. Bless us as we continue to behold the wonders of your work in the lives of so many who are yet to come to faith in Christ. Give your blessing to us now, we pray, in the name of Jesus, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Last Wednesday night, Brother Tom talked about the GPS. And he also talked about it in other ways than just being a GPS. But first and foremost, if you really need a ride to the church, you can call the church office and they will guide you here and get you back. But in a greater context thing, that's more than just get you here, it gets you a place where you can enjoy your service in the light of God and the opportunity to give, to make your impersonal investment in Christ. That's what that does. And that investment in that GPS does more than just that. It's an investment in God. It's Brother Tom talked about it being a spiritual GPS, being vertical with him and not less, and less, more or less, less horizontal and more vertical with him. So let's pray about that. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this opportunity this morning to witness, to pray. Father, we know these things, that the small investment that we make are bridges to others who need to see Christ, who need to hear about Christ, to understand. Father, we know all these things are important in our lives, and for those reasons, we want to make this small investment and return a portion to you. In your name, amen.
invitation song that we're going to sing this morning, Have Thine Own Way, is a great prayer to pray as you sing. If you're a Christian and you want God to be in control of your life, you want Him to direct all that you do, then pray as you sing, Have Thine Own Way, Lord, Have Thine Own Way. For you, if you have not yet surrendered yourself to Jesus Christ as your Savior, I want to encourage you to put your trust in Him. Don't wait. It never gets easier. It always gets a little bit more difficult, and you could run the risk of hardening your heart to the point that someday it will not matter. It will not matter to you if you surrender your life to Christ at all. I want to encourage you, why not receive the gift of eternal life here, now? So, let's stand together. Let's sing Have Thine Own Way. And those of you who will may come, we invite you to come.